Welcome everyone to another episode of AppSec 101. My name is Andrew Garrett, and I'll be your host for this episode. And I'm pleased to be joined today by Stan Wisseman. Stan, we've had you on here a couple of times in the past. Nice to have you on for another episode.
Good to be back, Andrew.
And today, Stan, we're going to be talking about, in the context of application development, what is a security champion? So maybe let's just start off with a basic definition. Stan, what's a security champion?
That's a good question, because it could mean a number of different things. But a security champion is someone who becomes the team security lead in a development project. Now, Gary McGraw coined the term satellite for this role years ago, and they've been called other things like security evangelists or black belts. Whatever you call them, here's the issue. You know, you got a culture of DevOps about improving the software lifecycle and reducing the complexity of maintaining software, and security needs to be part of that. And many times, security isn't part of it or seems to be out of sync with dev. And security champions can help by bringing together development and security mindsets so that the two roles can better understand each other. The key is that ultimately you want the champions to have a passion and an enthusiasm around security and improving the security posture of the applications they're supporting.
Yeah, and that passion is important, like you mentioned. So how do you identify security champions? Do you just look for kind of the most passionate people, or what do you look for?
To some degree, I mean, actually the backgrounds can vary pretty widely. They could come from development or QA or be an architect. And occasionally somebody from the cybersecurity side has that background. But like I mentioned before, you know, they usually have the background necessary to be credible when dealing with non-security folks on a project team and be that bridge. When the leader of the champions program, there usually is such a thing, is identifying potential champions, they need to have approval from managers at all levels involved. That's like the project or product owners, the direct team managers of the champions you're nominating, as well as buy-in from the security side of the house. And they should over-communicate what they're trying to do. Dev leadership can also help as far as identifying potential champions and choosing eligible candidates and helping conduct interviews to make sure they have the right capabilities. You also want to make sure they have the right skills on, you know, communication and soft skills, you know, so interpersonal communication skills is very important. You may have to sell the role to the candidate champions as well. You need to make sure that you describe the role clearly and explain the strategy and the plan to adopt this concept, as well as what the advantages are of becoming a security champion. That could be things like a chance to, you know, attend various security conferences or be part of the security meta team. Personal development is a big part of this too, and perhaps ultimately looking at things differently. So they have to ensure there's buy-in from the folks they're nominating as well.
Yeah, and Stan, let's talk a little bit about the specific responsibilities of a security champion. What does kind of the day-to-day look like for a security champion?
Yeah, so as I mentioned a moment ago, you know, security champions should have well-defined goals and purpose. Specific responsibilities of a champion can vary depending on the organization or program that they stand up. But in general, a security lead on a project team, you know, are the ones that are raising the risk issues associated with existing code or may conduct static or dynamic scans. They're enforcing secure coding best practices on the projects they support. They help prioritize security stories in the backlog of a project. You know, developing threat models in design or, you know, assessing threats of new features is part of the process. If that's something they do, they could be monitoring for vulnerabilities in open source software or actually in the dev tool chains that the development team is using. And if they are using some kind of bug bounty program, these are the folks that will typically be investigating the reports that come out of that, that are associated with their applications. Security champions, you know, are the ones that many times are validating the huge amount of security issues that can come in. You know, they may have to, unfortunately, over and over again, explain what a SQL injection is or a cross-site scripting vulnerability is to a developer and explain why they should care. It's also important to note that, you know, protecting security best practices shouldn't only fall on the security champions. Rather, it really should be a collective effort for the entire project team. So ultimately, what we want is the entire team working with the security champions to ensure that security application is what it needs to be.
Yeah. So who does the security champion report to? Would it be the cybersecurity team?
Typically not, actually. You would think so, right? But security champions usually do have a dotted line to the application security team, but they're not usually sourced from the cybersecurity team. The application security team usually has someone that'll oversee the champion program. That's what I mentioned before. Usually that's in the AppSec team. But the cybersecurity team in general usually doesn't have the pool of resources necessary, either the numbers or the skill sets to source the coverage needed for champions. You know, depending on the scope of the custom development that's going on within the organization, you may need tens of champions to cover active development projects. So usually they formally report up through wherever they were before, like the development team or the QA side of the house.
The more I'm learning about security champions, you know, the more I learn about, they really have a lot of responsibilities. So what's the best way for them to get up to speed so they can effectively deliver on these responsibilities?
No, you make a good point. They do have an important role. And honestly, once you've nominated somebody, you get them on board, you got to make them feel special. They're now part of that cybersecurity meta team or community, and they should officially be welcomed into that broader team and in some way get some swag so they can have a bit of swagger, you know, and opportunities for continuous learning and fun activities for the champions. That's helpful. You know, let's face it, application security is its own discipline. It requires specialized knowledge. So these champions need to grow their own knowledge base on the subject of AppSec, as well as more broadly on cybersecurity. Some organizations have a training regime that has progressions of belts as far as a way of demonstrating different levels of competencies or different areas. Those that achieve like black belt status are respected as true champions. I mean, adding to their swagger. Some firms, actually, one of the things they do is they bring in consultants who are experienced at being security champions and DevSecOps, and they model the role. They help build up the internal resources so they can eventually take it over. But that's a good way of jump-starting a program and helping making sure it's successful.
So I like this idea of kind of making them feel special and making them feel like they're part of a team. So let's talk a little more about that. You know, as far as welcoming them onto the team, getting them up to speed, what resources are out there to help them get to the level they need to be at?
So the role definition, which is pretty important that they understand when they sign up, and it's agreed to by all parties, this is the scope of the role. It needs to be posted as a reference, not only for the champions, but for others they're working with. And that may evolve. So you recognize that over time, that role may evolve and that definition needs to evolve as well. The secure development best practices and, you know, the target risks and vulnerability category should also be clearly defined and available. There are a lot of external resources. I mean, if you look at OWASP, there are things like the ASVS and the mobile ASVS, which is a vulnerability kind of framework for applications. There's the security knowledge framework. There's CERT, secure coding standards, there's SafeCode. There's lots of resources out there that you can point the AppSec champions to. You may want to identify specific ones that are most important. But let's face it, just like any job, one of the things you have to do is keep them motivated. To your point, they have a lot of responsibilities. What can you do to make it fun? Help them continue to learn. You could do things like security quizzes or hackathons. You can have a security defect of the month or a monthly newsletter. I mean, whoever's running that champions program needs to keep that momentum going.
Yeah, and earlier, Stan, you mentioned when you're identifying a security champion, you really need to hone in on someone who has good communication skills, you know, someone that's a good people person. So, I mean, how do you do that? How do you ensure that this communication is happening effectively?
Well, I think, again, you know, they are required to have that communication set of skills, and also they need to be doing that communication effectively with the team members and the project leaders. You can leverage a variety of different communication tools that are available within the company to collaborate effectively. I do think that it's a combination of technical data as, you know, to help ensure that they are consistent in the guidance they give. So, making sure they have secure access to appropriate knowledge bases that they can then leverage to share that with their team. And they want to make sure that's consistent across the different champions that they're giving the guidance to the project teams effectively. And one of the things that you want to try to avoid is isolation. So instead of everyone working in remote small groups and they don't exchange knowledge, you want to make sure that they're doing that and collaborating. So I do recommend things like wikis or, you know, taking advantage of the features on MS Teams if you have that, having some kind of communication channel like Slack that connects the champions among themselves, much less with the broader, you know, security meta team, you know, that's associated with the company. So, you know, look for ways to enable that with the tools that you have available.
Yeah. Yeah. And if they're working remotely, like you and I, you know, maybe they turn their cameras on every now and then so you can actually see somebody.
What a concept.
Yeah. Well, Stan, I appreciate you taking some time to speak with us about this today. Before we wrap things up, I wanted to just finish up with kind of the why. You know, why should we have a security champion? What are the benefits of having this type of role on your team?
Yeah, so I mean, security champions play a significant role in DevOps because they introduce that sense of responsibility for security within their department or within the projects they support. Their participation, you know, typically starts small and increases gradually. They can help ensure that there really is a SEC and DevSecOps, you know, and a desired outcome for the champions program is to create and foster a security culture in the development project teams in the organization. And once a champion program is established properly and the champions are flourishing, you know, that it's a great way of spreading that culture in the organization and achieving the goals that they have for application security as a whole. You know, and it's, you know, it, and I've seen this being, it's been fun to watch these individuals buy into it, into the role and get enthusiastic, and then they develop professionally too. So, I mean, it's actually a great way of giving somebody professional growth opportunities. And when they go all in, look out.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm glad you brought up the point of putting the SEC and DevSecOps because, you know, we hear it all the time, but, you know, really you just need someone in that role to make sure that the SEC is getting in there and that you're not leaving out security, right?
And these are the ones that typically are holding that torch in the project teams. You know, they're the ones actually doing that heavy lifting. And again, if you can get the culture then rolling many times from their enthusiasm and their activities, the other team members start getting it. The light bulbs come on.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and then once, you know, that security culture is established, it doesn't become foreign to people. It's now second nature and it becomes embedded as a part of your culture, which is ultimately what we want.
And this doesn't happen overnight. So it does take time. So the reality is it could be a multi-year journey to actually stand up a program and roll this out through your dev teams. Because you typically start with a pilot or two, and then over time, it catches on. So you just have to stay with it. And that leader of the champions program is essential too.
Yeah, no, that's great. Well, once again, Stan, thanks for taking some time to speak with me today. This was great. I'm sure we'll have you on again on another future episode. And, you know, to our viewers, thanks for watching this episode. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them down below. And don't forget to subscribe to Fortify Unplugged. Thanks, everyone, for joining us, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks, Andrew.
Thanks, Dan.